Welcome back to another episode of Server Room. This time I have a technical evangelist of ManageEngine, Shehnaaz, with me. Welcome to this episode.
Hi, Sharon.
Hi.
From the time you started this, I've been so stoked and happy for you. I'm glad we're able to sit here and talk to each other.
Same, likewise. And I heard that you were in Italy for work. How was that experience?
Yeah, we went on a ManageEngine roadshow. We went to 4 different cities in Italy. It was my first time there as well, meeting the security communities there. Mm-hmm. So it was pretty interesting. Okay. And I learned a lot of new things. Mm-hmm. There was a lot of mutual learning happening between the attendees and me. So it was a very good experience overall.
Great. Have you been on any other podcasts or do you have any favorite shows in mind?
Favorite shows as in series or like?
No, podcasts.
Not anything at the moment or at the top of my head that I can remember, but I do follow a few security podcasts myself, but I've never been on one.
Okay. And so this is the first time.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So today we'll be discussing how security requires perpetual learning and not outdated or stagnant knowledge. So to start, let's talk about your perspective on security. How has it evolved from the time you first learned about it until now?
So my journey with security has been very organic because the minute I finished college, I got into security. I've always been interested, but I got into security the minute I finished college. And I've stayed with it for close to half a decade now, which means I genuinely like it. I developed an interest towards it. But it's been quite a journey because when I first got into it, I thought, okay, if I check off all of these things off my list, I will gain so much knowledge. But it never worked that way. Yeah. So the more I dug deep into each and every concept, the more I discovered that there is a lot more to what you can see on the surface. So that always fascinated me, and that also sometimes overwhelms me as well. Because the more you get into something, the more you feel like, oh, I do not know a lot about this subject. But I made my peace with it. I thought, okay, if this is the field I want to be in, if this is something that I would genuinely be interested in, say, 10 years from now as well, I'd rather put my head down and start learning. So my journey with security has been a one with a lot of highs and lows and a lot of learning. And right now I'm at a place where I've made my peace. I know I have to keep going, keep learning, and keep updating myself with all that's happening. But at the same time, when I first got into it, you're given a few things to learn, right? You get started with a few things at least. So when I got started with those things, I identified that a lot of people who are still in security may still have their doubts with those subjects as well, with those concepts as well.
No one's an expert.
No one can be, is how I feel. That's my opinion. There are a few people who have perfected this as well, but it takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of learning, a lot of commitment.
But yes, it keeps evolving, so there's no way we can know
so anything. True. Yeah, because the minute you start learning about a legacy technology, let's say Active Directory or something that's been here for quite some time, and then you look at something on the other side where now I think is the time where AI has taken over. So the other side is evolving so rapidly, and these problems or these concepts still exist. So you need to cover from here to here. So it's a long bridge.
Especially these days, it's quite challenging.
Definitely. So if you're ready to commit and learn, then it's a great place to be in. And I personally like it. I personally enjoy the learning process as well. So yeah, it's quite nice right now.
Yeah, it's nice to hear about that. I'm sure you would have interacted with a lot of IT teams throughout your journey.
Even you have interacted with IT teams.
Slightly. I'm sure you would have interacted more. So, what have been some major takeaways from those interactions?
Actually, that has been a very pivotal change. So when I first got into cybersecurity, my learnings were from materials available online, my mentors, and writing about security concepts, because that also helped us learn. So the minute I got out there and met somebody from another part of the world that is into security, the minute I learned how they feel about security and the actual problems that they have, the perspective I had or the knowledge I gained sort of went into a transformation, and I could apply it in a new way now. Because with most of my interactions with people from different IT teams, let's say I was in a room of 50 people, the minute I ask how many of your organizations have more than a 5-member IT team, not more than 10 hands go up.
Okay.
So people are always siloed in. They're okay. always pressed for time.
So you're saying that there are less people in the security department?
Okay. Yes, in most of the organizations.
Okay. Is it security or just IT?
In IT security is okay. what I'm okay. saying. So if okay. someone is managing the security of an organization, I've spoken to people who are just a one member IT team.
Okay.
So they do everything.
So one person for the organization security.
Everything, okay. yes. Okay. Let's say it's like a 100 member organization. It is still an organization. Yeah. It still has data. Okay. It still has mm-hmm. to run. It still has to be secure. Mm-hmm. So in that case, if it's just one person mm-hmm. doing the entire security, mm-hmm. my perspective changed as to what will that one person need mm-hmm. or what can we provide mm-hmm. to help that one person do security well and properly. Yeah. Sure. So with my interaction, one thing I found out is there's always a demand for mm-hmm. IT security professionals, mm-hmm. yet there's always budget crunches. There's always...
Yeah. People are yeah. not ready to invest. Yeah. They take it lightly.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say lightly. I would just say this doesn't come as a priority to mm-hmm. someone who is building the next tech or next yeah. big thing right. that is going to go out in the market.
But that has changed in the recent years, right? Slightly, because people nowadays do take sometimes security seriously. Do you think?
Probably during the audit months. Or okay. but they do, yes. That transition has happened. People do take security seriously, but do all organizations have the funds that they would like to have to invest in security tools? No. Mm-hmm. Do they have enough number of people on the IT team? Also, no, mm-hmm. mostly, in most cases. Mm-hmm. So with that in consideration, people are now moving towards having something holistic mm-hmm. that can give them everything in their hands. So it's easy for them to perceive it. And also on the other side, a lot of organizations can have multiple solutions, mm-hmm. huge teams, or, you know, they give that out to other servicing companies that manage security for them. So in both cases, there's always discrepancies. In both cases, there's always one thing or another that someone would miss. Mm-hmm. I'm not trying to be pessimistic, but security works that way. There could be one thing or another yeah. that is making the organization yeah. vulnerable. So my interaction with the IT teams has always taught me that if you give them 10 things, there's always another thing that people might need. Mm-hmm. And if you're able to tailor the solutions that you're vouching for or the technology that you're vouching for to fit those demands, mm-hmm. to fit those needs, then that is where we're solving an actual problem. Mm-hmm. And if we fail to do that, and if we have a tailor-made tool, and if we tell them, hey, take this, it's not going to work for them. Because organizations are also evolving. It's very yeah. different now yeah. than it was earlier.
So yeah.
So there are a lot of challenges when it comes Definitely. To security. Security is the backbone of any organization, be it small or yeah. medium or maybe a Fortune 100 company.
For sure.
So what are the key areas that organizations must focus on?
So with respect to security, I would always go back to the basics. Because one thing I understood when I was learning about different technologies that came out in terms of cybersecurity, let's say there's network security, there's endpoint security, cloud security, and everything in between. But all of this is trying to protect the organization that you have. So as an organization, let's say if you and I start an organization, what we should be focusing on is getting the basics right. So if I have a software, is it up to date? If I have a few things in my infrastructure, is there anything that's operating with default settings or default credentials? Mm-hmm. And are there any misconfigurations? Now, these are the things that we should try and fix. And this is at an organizational level, but at a user level, there are a lot of things that can go wrong. Sharon, have you ever seen Defender on your computer?
I'm sorry, but no. What is
it? Defender is like the first layer of security. Mm-hmm. It comes with a lot of Windows machines as it is. Mm-hmm. So it's the layer one of security. Okay, let's move on. Do you have an antivirus?
I think my organization has yes. installed an antivirus yes. yeah, for that. Yeah.
The same organization.
Yes.
So yes. you have a CrowdStrike
yeah.
Falcon.
I'm sure they're taking care of security.
It is taken care of, trust me.
Yeah.
So you have a CrowdStrike Falcon on your machine. All of us do. Mm-hmm. So what happens there is I have a Defender as well. Or I had a Defender as well on my machine. So you go on to PowerShell, which you can also access, by the way. You go on to PowerShell, write a one-line script, mm-hmm. and you can delete Defender signatures. I'm not talking about disabling a security mm-hmm. tool. I'm talking about making it idle by deleting everything that's behind it, that's inside okay. of it. So it'll become an idle sitting duck instead okay. of performing what it has to do.
Okay.
I can do that mm-hmm. with no privileges today mm-hmm. as an end user. Mm-hmm. with just one line of code. Mm-hmm. And I can do the same thing with a few more lines of code for your antivirus and for my antivirus as well.
Right.
So what organizations should be focusing on is that users now have access to so much information. I'm not a hacker, right?
Yeah,
I learned cybersecurity, and there's on you find everything online.
Yeah.
You find codes, you find snippets of malware.
Is there any way that we can prevent someone, you know, writing a code on the Defender application or the antivirus software?
No, you can trust your users, you can educate them to not do it.
Okay.
But if someone wants to become an insider, someone wants to turn against you, there's not much you can do. So if they're like...
There's a vulnerability there.
Definitely. Insiders are always a threat. You and I are always a threat to this organization. So as long as we decide to not misuse the privileges or abuse the privileges that we have, the organization can be secure. So in that regard, someone with zero privileges can do so much. So you cannot put all the money on the people and trust your users as it is. So the next thing you can do is be quick to detect. So if something like this happens, how quickly can you detect it is the question that organizations should be asking right now. And that's where I think we should be looking at, and we should be focusing and investing our time and money and energy on.
Okay.
Also, I'll give you another example.
So the first line of defense is important, right?
Any layer of defense is important. They can break into any layer of defense, but the question is how quickly are organizations going to detect it?
Mm-hmm.
I'll give you another example. Do you use Grammarly?
I used to, but now I don't, thanks to ChatGPT.
Oh God, that is a whole conversation.
We'll come to that.
We'll come to that,
That is a whole conversation. So I was just going to ask you if you use any browser extension. On your browser.
I do, but not regularly.
But you have browser extensions.
Yeah, I do, yeah.
So every time you install a browser extension, where do you install it from? You install it from App Store or from the legitimate store, or at least you think it is legitimate.
App Store.
Yes. So you think it's a legitimate browser extension, but there are a lot of browser extensions that may not be legitimate that can lurk around in the very same stores, and you can download and install them. There is a way to prevent this. There is a way to identify legitimate browser extensions. There is a list of legitimate browser extensions with their snapshot IDs. So for every extension, there's a snapshot ID.
Okay.
And this information has been here for decades.
Okay.
It's just that we're not looking at the right places.
Yes. Or and we're not aware also.
Exactly.
The other problem is, even if we are aware, even if we have a plethora of information online, how much do we implement them?
That's also another different...
So that's one area that organizations should be focusing on.
Yeah, true. So security, we've spoken about it. So what kind of threats are out there at the moment? Are organizations prepared enough?
Oh, threats these days are very, very interesting, Sharon. I know I shouldn't be saying this, but they come in a lot of shapes and forms and in a lot of varieties.
Mm-hmm.
So there can be a threat directed at your Active Directory by an email phishing attempt. That is how things have been all the while. But now threats have become very, very nuanced. Do you connect to public Wi-Fi?
Yeah, sometimes, really. I do. When I go to a public place, of course.
Like a theater or cafe or a mall.
Yeah, or an airport.
Yeah.
Yeah, mostly cafe, yeah. But I don't take my work laptop there, so... I think I'm safe.
You are.
But there's this culture.
We don't connect to...
Yeah. There's this culture of people going to cafes and working out of cafes all the time, you know, Starbucks and other places.
Yes.
So as when I travel for work, when I'm at an airport and I see Wi-Fi connections and my transit is 2 hours, I have to talk to my family. So the minute I see that, I connect to any Wi-Fi that is available, at least I used to. So what happens when you connect to a public unsecure Wi-Fi that doesn't ask for an access code is that anybody who can eavesdrop that network and the connection between you and the network can see what you're doing, your social media activity, anything that you do. So I tried breaking into one of those public Wi-Fi networks using Wireshark, which is a very famous network analyzer that's open source as well. So anybody can use it. You can install it and use it today. So when you use Wireshark, you can literally see packets after packets for that specific Wi-Fi connection. If you tap into 802.11, it's going to give you packets after packets, and you get a lot of information, a lot of important information that is really sufficient for you to understand a lot about the person, the domain that they're working for.
Okay.
And if they're tunneling to a VPN, you'll be able to see where they're doing it and how they're doing it as well.
Okay.
So that is a problem.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of Wi-Fi based attacks are on the rise. And also there's another interesting attack that I read about. I was in Southeast Asia earlier this year, and there they use a lot of Lime scooters. It's available across the world. So it's like a bike.
Yeah, you can just scan.
Okay.
And you can pay online, and you can just use the scooter to just go around the city. So there was a scam where cyber attackers have stuck QR codes
on top
of
the existing ones.
Yeah.
Ever since
I've been very paranoid to use
one. Exactly. And you cannot even identify the malicious QR code because they all look the same. So how do we even know about it?
You know, I said this example in the last event that I was at. And then at the end of the show, I put a QR code on my slide deck for feedback. None of them were open to scanning it.
Really? Where was it?
This was in Italy.
Oh, okay.
So this was just because we gave them an example of how someone can misuse something as simple as a QR code.
Yeah.
So threats are there, and I'm glad that people are aware and people are not very open to, you know, succumbing to these threats. But threats are of different kinds now, and it's very important that organizations also tap into identifying these kind of vulnerabilities.
Do you have any tips specifically for these QR code attacks? But because there's no way we can identify it. Is there any way, as a cybersecurity expert, you have any tips for us?
Expert is a big word. So, but as an end user, I can tell you a few things. So one thing, see, I did do my research about it, but not a lot of things have been very clear about how you can stay away from those threats. You can just look at where the URL is redirecting to, which I don't think a lot of us will prudently look at.
Yeah, exactly.
And to see if it's an HTTPS or an HTTP.
Yeah.
So the best thing to do would be to not just randomly scan anything and everything, and to just do it in only in reputable places. At least from a very selfish organization point of view, do not involve domain computers or do not involve devices that are part of your domain or your work mobiles in these kind of scams, so that even if it's a single person attack, it's fine. If it's like an organizational level attack, it's a lot of loss and damage. So that's
The US police have warned their residents not to scan QR codes on parking meters.
Yes,
so
that also happened. Similar to this, yes.
So it's that relevant now.
So at an organizational level, what they can do is now they know that these are the kind of attacks that can come. So when someone scans a QR, it's basically going to probably redirect to a malicious site and install something in the backend.
Yeah.
So organizations need to track and constantly audit if something is downloading out of the ordinary. And here's where it gets a bit tricky. So you and I will have the access and credentials to download something and install something on our laptops. But if it's out of the ordinary, let's say it's out of your behavior in your network, then the security solutions that the organizations are investing in should be able to capture that.
Yes.
And user and entity behavior analytics is one such technology that can help capture, you know, these kind of threats, where it understands the behavior of every user and also the entity. So if either the user or the entity are acting very weirdly, then it's going to say, hey, this is not normal. Probably you need to look at what's happening with the user or the entity. So that is something that I've seen. And this is where privilege abuse also comes into play.
Yeah, true. So a security solution is the right way to go, is what you're saying, right?
Detecting quickly is the right way to go.
Okay.
So security solutions, yes, you cannot operate, you cannot have an organization without that. But how quickly can you detect? How prudent are you in identifying that something bad has happened?
Yeah.
So that is where you can save a lot of money. That's where you can save a lot of reputational damage, is my understanding.
Yeah. Actually, when a user scans the QR code or any other, you know, malicious, if they are into a malicious, if they log into a website or any sort of thing, I think in most cases, they identify about that only later, after they become a victim. It's not very easy for them to identify quickly.
Yes, in fact, so even if with the PowerShell commands that I told you to disable Defender or your antivirus, it will take the organization some time to identify, hey, this person's computer has disabled this, or this person is doing this, so let me give them a call. So if that call doesn't happen quickly, then it is a problem. In fact, if an attacker is already part of your organization, on an average, it takes about 200 days to even identify that someone is lurking inside your network.
Okay.
So we are that far behind. But I also read something very interesting, or rather I saw this happen, is that a few ransomware attack groups, they attack organization after organization, and their wait time used to be lesser 2-3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I was looking at a few of the attacks 3 years ago. I don't want to name the group.
Okay.
But right now, their wait time is 8 days.
Okay.
So they go behind organization after organization with an interval of 8 days, and we take 200 days to identify that we are under.
Why do you think the wait time has reduced in the
for them?
Yeah.
Because they have an MO now.
Okay.
And
what does that mean?
They have a modus operandi. So they have a way in which
okay.
they attack an organization.
Okay.
And if it worked for them, they want to do it in another similar organization
okay.
with the same infrastructure.
Okay.
So it works best
mm-hmm.
for them. And one more thing here is, so the minute, let's say, one of our peer organizations got attacked, the minute they get attacked, it's very easy for us to get all the information about the attack in this day and age. 10 years
yeah.
ago, probably not, but today, definitely, yes. You get who was the attacker, what IP addresses did they use, what domains did they use, what URLs, what file hashes were used, and all of that information. Now, that is called threat intelligence, and it is all open source. You go online, go to any threat feed, you will have millions of what we call indicators of compromise for any kind of attack. So let's say a peer organization was attacked and we have about 100 indicators of compromise.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if the same indicators of compromise attack our organization, then the fault is entirely ours.
Mm-hmm. We should have been aware. Mm-hmm.
So there are about 75 or 80 million indicators of compromise as we speak online.
Okay.
But are we safe from all of them? But what can we do to be secure from at least a few of them, few of the attackers that are still doing the rounds?
Mm-hmm.
So that is why their wait time or their, you know, time between the attacks is reduced considerably, because they're just moving rapidly
mm-hmm.
and we all have all the information, and we take our time to leverage the information that we have. But luckily, with security solutions, you can integrate threat intelligence, you can integrate user and entity behavior analytics with a SIM, that is. So with the security information and event management, with all of these additional integrations, it becomes very easy for you to make security holistic, for you to understand security in a comprehensive way.
Yeah, true. So let's talk about AI.
Oh,
AI,
wow.
Yeah.
you use ChatGPT a lot.
Yes, I do. AI is both a boon and a bane.
Yeah.
Now, creating deepfakes, generating malware codes is easier than ever. So, do you think we can ever be 100% secure against these cyber threats in the age of AI?
See, I genuinely don't think so. But on the contrary, AI is also used to make security tools more sharper.
Yes. Yeah, that's also
which is something I do not understand, because I do not understand, as in it is important, it is there, but it doesn't exist only for that. There are a lot of other things that
yeah.
AI does. I personally have never been a huge fan of the technology because I do not use it so much personally.
Mm-hmm.
But once when ChatGPT was everywhere and on the rise, I wanted to understand if someone was uploading sensitive data, will that be captured? Have you ever uploaded a file onto ChatGPT?
No.
Good for us.
Yeah.
Good for us.
Absolutely.
No, but there's a huge telecommunications provider. I'm sure you and I would have used their devices or anything that they had come up with. So there was a huge telecommunications provider, and one of their employees uploaded a semiconductor code information onto ChatGPT,
okay.
asking ChatGPT to fix the code.
Okay.
And it did.
Mm-hmm.
But they weren't able to. It will.
But.
No, sometimes it says, I'm sorry, I do not know what this
is. Oh, really?
Is
it yeah. And it doesn't, yeah. Actually, even I'm aware that it doesn't give accurate information.
Yeah, when you ask,
it's not updated.
Yeah, when you ask, are you sure it can go, maybe not. So
yeah.
With this person, this telecommunications provider, the code that they uploaded onto ChatGPT, it fixed it, but they weren't able to patent it,
okay.
and they weren't able to sell it. So that's how they made money. So they went on a lawsuit with ChatGPT, and it went on for 6 months, and at the end of it, the ChatGPT said, okay, fine, I'll delete the code. And that's all they got out of it. So if I take one of your belongings and give it to you after 6 months and I tell you I haven't tampered with it, I haven't opened it, you would trust me, but would you trust a random person?
Yeah, I wouldn't.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's also... So people feed personal information.
They do.
Yeah,
some people also feed organizational information. Let's say the other day I tried creating a bunch of data, like customer data or pricing details, and I uploaded it onto the platform just to see if it was able to give me anything.
Mm-hmm.
It gave me 5-year projections, it gave me everything that I needed.
Mm-hmm.
Now it has my data.
Mm-hmm.
That much
yes.
I know. So a security information and event management tool should be able to identify such cloud-based threats as well, because these applications, ChatGPT or let's say Grammarly, or let's say you use other SaaS applications on a daily basis, that is not Zoho, that is not something that we are authorized to use, there is always a risk.
Yeah. Do you think we need some new guidelines for these applications that are out there now?
I wouldn't say guidelines, but I would honestly say, I mean, guidelines is not something that we can come up with, but I would say that
I personally
think the organization should be aware of all the SaaS applications that we use. That much, yes. And these applications are actually called shadow IT.
Okay.
Because now our sysadmin knows that we use Zoho products, Zoho Writer and everything else that comes with it for our everyday activities. But suddenly if you use another SaaS tool, let's say you use Canva for making a presentation, they do not know of it.
Yeah.
I'm not saying we're doing it in bad faith,
mm-hmm.
but there could be people who can use other applications very carelessly and it could become a problem. All I'm saying is anything that you use with a domain computer or anything that you use where your work is related to it,
mm-hmm.
your IT admin must know.
Okay.
So there's a technology where your IT admin can get a list of all the shadow applications that are existing in your infrastructure at the moment, and it's called CASB, a cloud access security broker.
Okay.
And Gartner coined the term and they came up with it, and they called it, they said it's not a web application firewall, it's not a cloud firewall, it is a secure gateway that will track all the traffic that leaves your on-premises to the cloud and enters from the cloud to your on-premises, so that everything that takes place in a hybrid environment is captured.
Okay, so including the data we feed on
yes.
ChatGPT?
That, yes, I've been asked this so many times. We will not be able to identify the data because
okay.
it's the logs on the application end. So ChatGPT
so it's still a threat.
Definitely, it is definitely a threat. But what we can identify right now from our site is we can identify if files are being uploaded.
Mm-hmm.
We can identify the size of the file.
Mm-hmm.
And if we do not want our people to do it, we can ban the application as it is. So
yeah.
once you have the list of all the shadow IT, you can choose to sanction or ban the applications.
Yeah.
So you can ban ChatGPT altogether or any other application for that matter altogether if you want. Or you can sanction it and you can apply filters on the file uploads alone. So you
okay.
do not want anybody uploading files onto the platform.
Mm-hmm.
And if they do, you need an alert. So that is something
okay.
we can work
so
around.
So there's a, yeah.
Definitely,
yeah,
we do
yeah.
it, of course.
Great.
So
that's good to know.
Yeah.
So that is where we are with AI right now and SaaS applications and cloud security as it is. It is always a threat
mm-hmm.
and will always be. So the best thing to do would be to not feed so much information
yeah.
to it, but I understand it's also not very practical because
yeah.
if our organization or any organization is going to hire someone younger than us,
mm-hmm.
they're
yeah,
so
they
used to
yeah.
AI.
And it's also useful in some ways.
Definitely.
So
I
we cannot
say,
just
yeah.
negate it completely.
No.
But it comes with its risks, so we need to be
careful
reasonable and careful
using
while using it, yes. At least from an organizational perspective. At a personal level,
yeah, it doesn't matter.
Yeah,
yeah correct. It matters.
Definitely.
I shouldn't say that it doesn't matter, it matters.
It can affect you in
yeah.
weird ways. Speaking
so
of that,
lose money.
Yes.
Speaking of that, actually, there's another example. You know, back in the day, not so long ago, but there was a Colonial Pipeline ransomware attack, I think 3 or 4 years earlier. And the whole ransomware attack, the Colonial Pipeline is a huge pipeline in the U.S. that produced, that took care of a lot of regions
okay.
For natural gas and things like that.
Okay.
So the whole pipeline was shut down because
okay.
of a cyber attack.
Okay.
And that was because someone used their Facebook credentials as their VPN password as well. Their Facebook credentials got breached elsewhere.
Okay.
And they understood that this person worked for the Colonial Pipeline. They tried the same username and password.
Okay.
They were able to crack into the
okay.
VPN. And it incurred a huge loss. And a lot of people were also harmed because of this.
Yeah.
So personally, what we do also
so
definitely
matters.
Yeah.
yeah. Nowadays, yeah. So we'll keep that in mind.
Yes.
So my last question.
Wow.
What's in store for security? What is its future?
So probably the way forward, as we can put it, would be, for me personally, I learn a bit of basics. I learn all the basics, of course, but I focus a little bit on the basics, a little bit on what's happening right now to stay relevant. So I feel like organizations should first bolster the basics. If there's a misconfiguration, then no amount of security tool can secure you. Of course, you can detect something after it has happened, but prevention is never on the table with detection tools. So you have to bolster your basics, you have to keep them strong, and from then there on you have to understand the infrastructure as much as possible at an organization level, see where you need tools, fit those tools right in and work with the tools closely. And one more thing is, with all the IT teams that I've spoken with, all of them want easy to use tools. They do not want tools that complicate everything for them, because security as it is
complicated.
Is a lot.
Yeah.
They want things that simplify everything for them, and that's easy to deploy, easy to use, easy to work with. And if there's if they're looking at some analytics, they want to understand it right away as opposed to decoding what's shown for them. So I think simplifying security is very important. And I also feel that as a generation, we have to constantly learn security for the betterment of us and also for our, you know, for the people to come. Because right now, it's very important that all of us are security aware.
Yeah.
As individuals and also at an organizational level. So we have to constantly keep updating, constantly keep learning, and try and not fall prey to any of the activities that are happening around this, and be careful as much as possible. I think that's the only way to go forward, to learn and to go back to basics from time to time, and also stay relevant with what's happening in the market.
Great. So thank you so much for your time.
Sharon, thank you for having me.
It's my pleasure.
Of course, man, it's mine as well.
Yeah. So I hope to see you in another episode.
Sure.
Yeah, of course, I would love to be here. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. Thank you so much.